In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Dear brothers and sisters, in the name of Christ Jesus, I welcome you to our Cathedral Church. We are here to be united with the same Christ Jesus, so that through him we may offer sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to God our Father and the power of the Holy Spirit. During the sacred liturgy this afternoon, 12 men will present themselves to express their willingness and commitment to continue to be formed on their journey toward the order of the act. My welcome, my brother priests who are here, many of whom are the pastors of these candidates, also our deacons, a good number of whom were ordained just last week. And I certainly welcome the wives, families, friends, and parishioners of our candidates, all of them. For now we form one holy people, about to enter into the celebration of the liturgy. For a moment now we pause, and we might call to mind our need for God's forgiveness, but at the same time remember that he is full of gentleness and compassion. So in trusting ourselves again in his divine mercy, we seek from him to pardon. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, the Word of God, just proclaimed in the three scripture readings, is so instructive for us, the disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. This same divine word is also so appropriate for this sacred liturgy, in which 12 aspirants for the permanent diaconate will declare their desire to be admitted to candidacy for holy orders. God's word, especially in the first and third readings, focuses our attention on light dispelling darkness, and clearly points to the Lord Jesus Christ as the light penetrating and removing all darkness. In today's Gospel account, St. Matthew likewise clearly tells us that Jesus left Nazareth and went to live in by the sea, in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali, place of darkness, in order to bring to the people living there the light of his truth and of his grace, thereby fulfilling what the prophet Isaiah had said. People who sit in darkness have seen a great light. On those dwelling in a land overshadowed by death, light has shone, has arisen. Yes, God the Father sends His only begotten Son precisely to lead us from the darkness of error and sin into the light of His truth and grace. Jesus came to proclaim the kingdom of heaven, as today's gospel reminds us. That is, to proclaim God's reign among us. Jesus came to be our Savior and Lord, to lead us back to God, to enable us to live forever with Him. How desperately we need the light of Christ's truth and of His grace in our contemporary society. So much darkness abounds around us. For example, the neglect and often the denial of God's presence among us. The pervasive disrespect for the gift of life, beginning with terminating the life of a defenseless and innocent child in the womb through abortion, and violence, which inflicts its vicious blows in a variety of ways and places. Yes, we often sit in darkness, and dwell in a land overshadowed by death. But there is real reason to hope. For Jesus Christ continues to be among us, bringing light into darkness. He does this through those who belong to Him, who form His body. Church. He calls us to belong to Him. At our baptism, He said to each one of us, "Come after me," that is, follow me. I call you to take part in my mission of teaching, sanctifying, and shepherding through the specific vocation I will give to each of you. He keeps calling us as we journey in faith to draw closer to Him. Repent, He tells us, that is, turn back. Turn around. Come closer. The more we are converted and formed into His image, the more we can become apt instruments in His hand by which others come to Him. Remember, He tells us, "I will make you fishers of men." Yes, all the members of the church share in Christ's threefold office of teaching, sanctifying, and shepherding, each one within his or her particular state of life. Canon 204, paragraph 1, states this clearly, and I quote, "Christian faithful are those who, inasmuch as they have been incorporated in Christ through baptism, have constituted their own way, in Christ's priestly, prophetic, and royal function. They are called to exercise the mission which God has entrusted to the Church to fulfill in the world, in accord with the condition proper to each. End of quote. So then, as we each participate in Christ's threefold office, in ways proper to our individual state of life, we are thereby bringing to our society the light of Christ's truth and of his grace, the light that is Christ Jesus himself. At this Mass, let us recommit ourselves to living out more faithfully Christ's call to us, to come after him, and to be in him fishers of men. Christ chooses from among all the baptized some men to minister to his people as bishops or priests or deacons. Today, 12 men are seeking to be admitted into candidacy for holy orders. They will be formally admitted into a process of formation by which they will be prepared humanly, spiritually, intellectually, and pastorally for service to this diocesan church in the order of deacons. Let us now turn our attention to the sacred rite of admission to candidacy for holy orders. Dearly beloved, these, our brothers, are here today in the presence of the Church to be recommended to us and to you for admission as candidates for holy orders. Christ gave this command: ask the Lord of the harvest to send laborers into his harvest. Aware of the Lord's concern for his flock, and realizing the needs of the Church, our brothers consider themselves ready to respond generously to the call of the Lord, trusting the Lord, in whom they lift the hope of faithfully fulfilling their vocation. They say with the prophet, "Here I am, send me." But the call of the Lord must be heard and understood by means of signs, which reveal daily to the wise the will of God. Those whom God chooses to be sharers in the ministerial priesthood of Christ, he prompts and helps with his grace. At the same time, he entrusts to us the task of inquiring about the candidate's aptitude. Once they have been duly tested, we will call and ordain them, marking them with the singular seal of the Holy Spirit for the ministry of God and the Church. For by holy orders, they will be deputed to continue the saving work of Christ, which he accomplished on earth. Therefore, when the time comes for them to be associated with our ministry, they will serve the Church and build Christian community by the preaching of the Word and the celebration of the sacraments. address these words to you, who have already begun the formation. Through this formation, you will learn each day to live according to the gospel and to be strengthened in faith, hope, and charity. By practicing these virtues, you will grow in the spirit of prayer and in zeal to win all mankind for Christ. Compelled by the love of Christ, strengthened by the inner work of the Holy Spirit, you arrive at the moment when you are to express openly your desire to be bound in holy orders for the service of God and humankind. This desire shall receive with joy. From this day on, you must cultivate more fully your vocation, using especially those means that can be offered to you as help and support by the ecclesial community entrusted with this task.
Antonio J. Remedios. Thank you.
Beloved sons, the pastors and teachers in charge of your formation and others who know you have given a favorable account of you. We have full confidence in your testimony. In response to the Lord's call, do you resolve to complete your preparation so that in due time, through holy orders, you be prepared to assume ministry within the church? Do you resolve to prepare yourselves in mind and spirit to give faithful service to Christ the Lord and his body, the church? Church accepts your resolve with joy. May God, who has begun the good work in you, bring it to fulfillment. Amen.
And to our choir.